When we lived without electricity most of my young life, we didn't know the restraints under which we survived. The most transforming element in my life was when our family finally got electricity. My family would go to bed before sundowners, and I would stay up until 8 o'clock when Glenn Miller came on, as a matter of fact. I would listen to him for 15 minutes.
This magnificent area, it's hard to believe that it was built on faith. It was quite a marvel of modern ingenuity when it was built. It would re-energize Atlanta and North Georgia after the Civil War, and become a popular getaway destination for many Atlantans. This area was created with a single vision: harness the power the water generates, but leave the land just as they found it. This is Lake Burton. It's part of the Tallulah Falls watershed. And it's here that a series of dams were built to provide power for a growing Atlanta and the entire state in the early 1900s. But this story really begins just before the Civil War, when a young Atlanta is experiencing growing pains.
From the very beginning, Atlanta was dominated not by farmers or by planters, but by businessmen. And by the 1850s, these men were so unified in their vision for the city's future that they actually took turns running for and being elected to seats on the city council and the mayor's position. And then in 1855, the city council appropriated money to produce a gas plant. And that gas plant led to 50 new gas lights to illuminate the downtown area.
These new street lamps came with one provision. The citizens would have to pay for the fuel. Atlanta's first street lamps were lit on Christmas Day, 1855, and would remain lit until Sherman destroyed them in 1864. The Civil War had destroyed nearly three quarters of the state's wealth. It would take the talents and foresight of an Atlanta banker named Henry Atkinson to see the need for an improved power system.
Well, after the Civil War, of course, the city had been depopulated by order of Sherman and then burned by order of Sherman. So there was a slow recovery immediately after the war, 1865 to 1870. It was sort of a long time coming, and the streets of the city and all that were routinely called mud holes, and they were, because there was no paving in the 70s. Some started, but not robust in any manner of way, and the result is rain and mud and all that would characterize the city as a place to live.
The railroad system was extensively destroyed. All four of the railroads that accessed Atlanta were seriously damaged. And yet Atlanta's entrepreneurs returned right away and started rebuilding the city. I mean, they had a sense of Atlanta's future, and they were not going to be deterred even by William T. Sherman. And so by early 1865, the city is already showing signs of being a vibrant place.
But the population began to build substantially. The root and branch mercantile operation here in Atlanta was beginning to build its way back. It had existed as a thriving enterprise before the war. And it came back in the 1870s to lead the Atlanta business community. Suburbs were beginning to develop by the time we roll out of the 1870s and into the 1880s. So that began to change the character of the community and the population.
It was during this time that a man named Henry Atkinson would come to Atlanta. Atkinson was a graduate of Harvard who had spent time as a cowboy, cotton buyer, and a banker. The Georgia Electric Light Company had opened in 1883. The company had one generating plant that serviced 22 electric streetlights. In 1891, Atkinson would use his banking contacts to take control of the company.
Atkinson was an interesting individual. Here he was, upbuilt in the South, but his uncle had been one of the leading abolitionists in the United States. He had helped fund the raid on Harper's Ferry. He had also helped finance the rifles that John Brown used in Kansas in 1859. Brown, of course, the radical abolitionist. So here he's come here, and he falls right in and becomes a part of the city. Now, on the other side is Preston Arkwright, who he brings in as his lawyer in about 1891 for putting together this street railway business.
By the 1890s, Edison's light bulb would begin to overtake gas lights in places like New York City. At the time, steam power generated direct electric current, or DC. However, DC power was expensive and could only travel short distances. Atkinson's new company would win Atlanta's bid to install the first electric streetlights. The early success of the Georgia Electric Light Company was documented in an Atlanta Constitution editorial on June 6, 1894. There is no better lighted system in America than Atlanta. And there's not a citizen in Atlanta who will not gladly testify to the excellence of the city's street lighting service. The Georgia Electric Light Company is fully deserving of commendation for its efforts to give the city a thoroughly efficient service. Night after night, the street lights scattered over a vast area burn with perfect regularity.
By 1890, Atlanta's population had grown to 65,000, and Atlanta was home to 10 railroads and 4 streetcar companies, 2 of them horse-drawn and 2 of them electric. And Atlanta began to build itself as a Phoenix city.
Grady was always on the cutting edge of technology, and electrification was coming into its own, and power companies were beginning to develop, and Grady was a great proponent of power production.
While the Georgia Electric Light Company could supply electric power to the public, it could not be involved in the booming street railway business. Atlanta's street railway lines were operated mostly by the Atlanta Railway and Power Company, owned by Joel Hurt. Hurt had built the first electrically powered street railway line in 1888. The streetcar was nicknamed the 9-mile trolley because of the 9-mile circle it made connecting neighborhoods in Virginia Highlands and Inman Park with downtown. The line also ran down Ponce de Leon Avenue and DeKalb Avenue, as well as Buckhead and Howell Mill. In order to compete with Hurt in this emerging business, Atkinson would buy the Collins Park and Belt Railroad and rename it the Atlanta Rapid Transit Company.
Joel Hurt was a man in Atlanta who had an interest in streetcar companies. And there were, and originally in Atlanta, there were very many streetcar companies. And Joel Hurt began gobbling them up one by one to put them into one organization. He had organized all of them in his group except for 2. But one year he put in his budget the funds to purchase Atkinson's Georgia Electric Light Company. The problem was he did not make an offer to Atkinson. He didn't even mention it to him. But Atkinson got wind of it through the grapevine. And so he countered that by he purchased one of the 2 streetcar lines that Hurt did not own. So after that, the fight was on.
By 1901, Hurt's Atlanta Railway and Power Company operated 33 and a third miles of railway, and Atkinson's Atlanta Rapid Transit Company operated 139 miles of street railway lines. The two would engage in numerous legal battles for control of the city's streetcar and power business. The legal battle between 2 of Atlanta's leading citizens was dubbed the Second Battle of Atlanta. Ultimately, Atkinson would resolve his legal issues with Hurt by buying his company. Atlanta was a transportation hub for the South. It had a street railway car system. The city's water supply was at Lakewood. Bell Telephone had 130 subscribers. The Atlanta Constitution had begun publishing in 1868. It would be in this environment that a man named Henry Grady would champion an idea for a new South, one based on industry and commerce, and not agriculture.
So Henry Grady became Atlanta and Georgia's most important spokesman for the idea of a new South grounded in commercial and industrial development. As an adult, Henry Grady became a journalist, and he moved to Atlanta in the 1870s and joined the staff of the Atlanta Constitution, first as a journalist, and then eventually as the editor and part owner. And the Atlanta Constitution was not only the most important newspaper in Atlanta, but it was the most important newspaper in Georgia and one of the most important newspapers in the entire South.
Grady had called a meeting of some 50, and Grady himself pledged $1,000. And all 50 came in on board and pledged $1,000 each. So the total was $50,000 for the exposition.
In 1894, Atlanta hosted the International Cotton Exposition, which was really a big deal. This is sort of a coming out party for Atlanta and the South. Henry Grady, the editor of the Atlanta Constitution at that time, gives a speech that was well covered and is still famous now, of talking about a new South.
We have established thrift in city and country. We have fallen in love with work. We have restored comfort to homes from which culture and elegance never departed. We have let economy take root and spread among us as rank as the crabgrass which sprung from Sherman's cavalry camps, until we are ready to lay odds on the Georgia Yankee.
That address touched all the mystic chords of what the South could become. And Grady painted a marvelous picture of a restored economy, restored farms. So it was a dramatic story that he was telling of a Southern turnaround.
And the new South, in some people's thinking, was a two-lane roads, freshly paved, and with electricity lines running along the road. That would be what changed the South, especially in these rural communities. Interestingly, whereas the city raised the money to have this exposition, $250,000, just very quickly by the leading citizens, Henry Atkinson could not get the money to help fund his railroad. The people really couldn't see the use of electricity at the time. Of course, electricity was in its infancy, but they couldn't understand this and what it would mean. But Atkinson and Arkwright, they understood the potential. Atkinson saw the potential in the South. He saw the potential of this frontier, economic frontier.
People began to flock to Atlanta as entrepreneurs, and entrepreneurialism was the touchstone of the New South.
The late 1800s would signify the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. But this new revolution came with some drawbacks.
Thomas Edison had invented the light bulb, and he had created his own power company, and he was generating power using DC current. The problem is, to get DC power to a home, you have to be close to the generator because you can't transmit that power far. You lose it. There was a better way of doing it. Edison had a Serbian immigrant named Nikola Tesla who worked for him. Tesla had designed an alternating current generator, a polyphase alternating current generator, and it overcame the shortcomings of DC by being able to transmit it long distances. During this time, there was a lot of battle for prominence in the electric industry. Tesla decided that he would go out on his own and market his product. So Nikola Tesla partnered with George Westinghouse, and they started building AC generators. And they actually won the lighting contract for the World Exhibition in 1895. The generators that operate inside Tallulah Falls plant carry the original Nikola Tesla George Westinghouse 1895 patent date. They've been in place since before 1900, and they run every day, nonstop.
While Atkinson and Arkwright continued to pursue their vision of the New South, a nationwide depression in the late 1800s would sweep the country. Bank operations in many cities ground to a halt, and Atlanta did not have the money to pay its bills.
I'll tell you how committed Atkinson was to the city, to Atlanta, to Georgia. Not long after the International Cotton Exposition in the late, before the turn of the century, late 1890s, Atlanta gets in bad financial situation. They don't have the money to continue to build infrastructure, to build the things they need to build to attract people, to attract industry. And so they can't raise the money, they can't sell bonds. So Atkinson goes to his contacts in New England, bankers, and gets them to buy the bonds. And the only way he gets them to buy the bonds is to personally guarantee them, you know, to personally back the bonds himself.
While Henry Atkinson would guide the growth of Georgia Power, Preston Arkwright would become the face of the company.
You know, Arkwright's background is that he grew up in Savannah. He graduated from the University of Georgia. He had a law degree at 20 years of age. Goes to work almost immediately with Atkinson as an attorney for him. He had other clients, of course. But Arkwright, his father-in-law, he marries an Atlanta woman, is a former Georgia governor and also a former Confederate general. So these guys come together. But they had one thing in common, and that is wanting to do something positive for society through business.
When Arkwright joined the company, one of his first tasks was to consolidate the company's three businesses, streetcar, electric power, and steam heat, into the Georgia Railway and Electric Company.
So that when it came time for their to issue stock for their new company, Georgia Railway and Electric Company, Arkwright, as his attorney, comes into the office one day and says, well, we've got the stock certificates. I've got, you know, there's several crates of them, and they have to be signed by the president. And Atkinson says, well, I'm not going to do that. I don't have the time to do that. I'm not going to sign all those things. Well, they have to be signed for by the president, Arkwright tells him. And then Atkinson is getting pretty annoyed now. He says, well, you be the president, and I'll be the chairman.
Arkwright was a born leader who proved adept at solving numerous problems. He believed that business had a social responsibility to the cities it served.
I became associated with this business in about 1891 as a young lawyer. I was associated with the Georgia Electric Light Company in Atlanta, and that company had just built a brand new plant. It had a capacity of about 1,000 kilowatts, I think. It ran a lot of arc lights, most of the lighting of street lamps, with a few lights in stores. There was very little electric lighting in homes back then. The company also furnished electricity to operate the street railroads in Atlanta. It was a one-town affair, a new business, newly invented. A business furnishing a service that was practically unknown before that time. I became president of the Georgia Railroad and Electric Company in 1902. It was a combination of the electric lighting and the street railroad services in Atlanta.
He would coin the phrase that would become the motto for the company, citizens wherever we serve.
Men in business should not forget that their character and self-respect are invested in the enterprise, as well as their money and work. Their reputation for moral character in addition to their personal happiness it brings, has for them a distinct commercial value. We have an even greater need than most for a strict adherence to moral principles.
Under Arkwright's guidance, the company's moral compass was set, and the partnership of Atkinson and Arkwright put their foot on the gas.
Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the crowd.
The company's streetcar business had proven to be a success, and Georgia Railway and Power was looking to expand its ridership.
And so the company, Power Company, decided in 1903 to build an amusement park. It was called the Postillion Amusement Park. It was located where the old Sears building is today. In the 1880s, there was baseball fever in Atlanta. Now, the fire chief in Atlanta was a baseball fan, and he wanted a winning team, so he talked Preston Arkwright, president of the Power Company, into purchasing the baseball team, which Arkwright did. And of course, his purpose was to increase more riders on the streetcars.
Then about 1906 or 1907, baseball is just getting started throughout America, and Atlanta has a team. They're the Atlanta Crackers, and they're playing elsewhere this time. And he comes up with the idea to take part of this land they own, that the amusement park was on, and build a baseball stadium. So he builds Ponce de Leon Park. And that becomes a hub of events and entertainment and sports for the city of Atlanta for the next half century. It was the site of Billy Graham's first crusade in Atlanta in 1950. It drew 25,000 people the first day. The park held, in its heyday, about 12,000 people. Nearly a half a million people came out to see Billy Graham over this six-week period when he was here in 1950.
During this time, the company would also acquire the Atlanta Gas Light Company and the Atlanta Steam Company. These acquisitions would allow Georgia Railway and Power to provide steam and electric power to the hotels, office buildings, and stores throughout the city.
When they first started building the grid powered by steam-powered generating plants, hydroelectric power didn't exist. But once it was developed, there was a land rush on dam building. A Union general named Harding came down here and was taken to Tallulah Gorge, which was a bit of a tourist destination. It's the deepest gorge in the East, 1,000 feet. It was the second leading honeymoon destination in the United States after Niagara Falls. There were 15 or 16 hotels there. Well, he came up there and looked down in it and said, we can generate a lot of power here. And he started buying land, and that failed. Other people came in.
The idea for the Tallulah Falls project began in 1906, when retired Northern General A.J. Warner created the North Georgia Electric Company to build and operate electric railroads and hydropower projects. Warner's company had begun acquiring land and building a railway system in Gainesville and Dahlonega. The North Georgia Electric Company had purchased 9 potential water properties that could be developed to provide power. But one obstacle stood in the way: the town of Burton, founded in 1875 by Jeremiah Burton.
There was one village, one town in Rabun County, Burton, Georgia. It was the second largest town in the county of Rabun. That town had church, it had schools, it had everything to be a self-sufficient village. It was a town of its own. It actually stood right in the heart of the valley where Lake Burton had to go. So part of the process for building that meant that entire town, including the cemetery, had to be relocated. Everybody sold their property, and when that lake was filled, all those homes were left standing.
So it was a big town. They also had crops. They were farmers as well. They had the syrup mill. They made sorghum and cane, just regular syrup, and of course, corn for the good old moonshine, corn liquor. They had a church, and the church was active, and I believe the church was part of the singing convention that they would have. They had a music school, pretty elaborate for the time. They would have all day long singing schools from like 9 o'clock till 3 o'clock.
As the Burton Dam was finally closed for the last time, a pioneer town would surrender to the rising water. In the spring of 1908, Eugene Ashley and Elmer Smith, who had developed hydroelectric plants in New York, met with Warner about his troubled company. They agreed to take over the company and renamed it Georgia Railway and Power Company.
People that began this place had a vision, and they decided that this was the greatest place to put a powerhouse where they could provide power for the city of Atlanta. So they decided to start with Tallulah Falls. Well, construction was difficult. One, no labor. Two, getting materials here was a major achievement. In addition to that, the town of Tallulah Falls at the time was a major tourist attraction, large hotels, and those tourist attractions lived on the gorge and the attraction of the gorge. And when the dam came along, that would destroy pretty much all of the business that those tourist industries had.
Once again, financial problems would plague the Tallulah development, and Ashley and Smith would sell the project to Henry Atkinson, who would begin the process of completing the construction.
As they did with all the other lakes, they had purchasing agents, people that would go around and purchase land from the owner if it could be found. So they hired a man named J.E. Hardy. He was from Tallulah Falls. He was a big man in girth. And there are accounts of him going around to the 65 families at Burton buying their land. And he wore a black coat, blue shirt, black pants, and a big black hat, rode in a buckboard with two horses. And he actually paid top dollar. So he bought out 65 families, and the Morse Brothers Lumber Company were contracted to come in and demolish the town.
But Atkinson needed additional land to complete the development, and a man named Andrew Jeanette was looking to sell some of his.
So he had heard about this dam down the river. So he got on the train in Clayton, rode to Atlanta, and he arranged to meet Mr. Atkinson, who was the chairman of the Georgia Power and Railroad and Power Company. So they went out and played a match of golf. Jeanette relates that Atkinson didn't want to talk about the land. He didn't want to talk about the dams. He didn't want to talk business. So he left with the impression he wasn't really interested. Well, about a week later, an engineer from the Railroad and Power Company contacted him and wanted to buy the 1,000 acres. So Jeanette went, So he said, I'll take 50,000. Well, he took 40,000 and thought he had gotten a great deal. But later he says in his book, he says, I was incredibly naive. I had no idea about hydroelectric power and how valuable this land was. And I could have easily asked 150,000. So the site where the Burton Dam is was kind of decided over a golf game.
While the Tallulah project was ambitious, it also aroused opposition. One of the leading opponents was Helen Dortch Longstreet, the second wife of Confederate General James Longstreet. Longstreet owned two weekly newspapers that she used to promote her strong political beliefs, along with lifelong efforts to honor her husband's Civil War service.
Another cause that she espoused was opposing Georgia Power's efforts to put a dam at Tallulah Falls. She was not against hydroelectric power, but she believed that a dam in this instance would really ruin this beautiful natural site. And so she formed the Tallulah Falls Conservation Association, and she went all over the state of Georgia campaigning against Georgia Power, calling them pirates and buccaneers and all kinds of terrible names. She failed in her effort, and the dam was put in.
The company would build a series of six dams and power plants that would encompass 28 miles of the Tallulah and Tuggalo rivers. The last of the six dams would create Lake Burton in August of 1920. It would encompass over 2,700 acres and 62 miles of shoreline.
Thank you.
it's accomplished took a lot of engineering marvel. The people that designed this thing, they had slide rules and paper and a pencil. No computers. The people that built this thing had to rely on men and mules and steam power. This thing came about at the end of the steam age. This was the beginning of the electric age.
By 1910, a fund of $10 million had been raised, the near equivalent of $300 million in today's dollars. An entire company town would be assembled, and hundreds of workers would begin construction of the Tallulah Falls power plant without the benefit of cranes, diesel engines, or any modern equipment. It would require the construction of a vertical track for a steam-driven cable car to carry men and equipment to the new power plant. It would descend 1,200 feet into the Tallulah River Gorge and would be the steepest incline of track ever constructed.
So the plant had to be situated a mile away from the dam, and a tunnel was built to divert the water from the dam to the top of the gorge at the plant site. Now, to get everything down there meant you had to install a railway. So a funicular railway, incline railway, was built, and at the time it was steam powered. There was no other way to operate it. Today, that same railway is the only access to the plant.
In 1911, only a few good roads existed between Atlanta and Rabun County. In order to build this massive project, a series of railroad tracks were built to move the men and building supplies to the construction site. But the mountainous terrain created a number of problems. They devised a series of narrow-gauge railroad tracks called short lines, or, as the workers call them, dinky trains. When the dams were completed, the dinky trains had carried 30,000 tons of materials and 400,000 passengers without a single accident. By 1914, five 12,000-watt generators were operating, making the Tallulah Falls project the third largest hydropower installation in America. The North Georgia hydroelectric system would revitalize industrial development. More than $450 million would be invested in factories and industries, and over 600,000 jobs would be realized. Lake Burton had become a popular summer getaway for many Atlantans. It was a place to escape the summer heat. Margaret Mitchell and her husband would be among those who chose the lake as a summer destination. The first transmission lines from the Tallulah plant were run to a substation on Boulevard Street. From there, lines were extended to Noonan, Marietta, Cartersville, Aragon, Lindale, and Rome.
In 1927, Preston Arkwright goes to Atlantic City to deliver a keynote speech to the National Electric Light Association industry meeting, which at that time, that was the leading industry group in this fast-growing electric utility industry. And in his speech, the company is really expanding now. The company is expanding outside of Atlanta. And he begins to talk about how the company is expanding. When Georgia Power goes into different towns, they go, he says, not as a transient, not as a tourist, not as a peddler. They go as a permanent resident, that we will be a citizen wherever we serve. When he goes into these different communities, he brings Georgia Power. We're here to stay. We're here to serve. He made it a big deal. And when they went into a town, they would come in with this marching band would come in. And this was a big deal in this town of, 2,500 people here. There were times when they would go into communities that were, really wanted the electricity and hadn't had any electricity or reliable, and the townspeople would throw a barbecue for them or a picnic. I mean, it was electricity coming to your community then was a really big deal.
The company's growing pains were creating communication problems between the substations and the home office. H.L. Wills and George Eiler conceived the idea of establishing a radio telephone system from the office on Walton and Fairley to the power plant.
H.L. Wills was an engineer in the electrical department at Georgia Power, and his name, his nickname was Dad. They called him Dad Wills. And he built the first transmitting and receiving radio equipment in the Southeast. That was before World War I. And during the war, the government took over his equipment for military purposes. But after the war, Dad Wills and George Eiler and A.W. Shropshire, they were engineers in the company, the three of them built the first radio broadcasting station in the Southeast. It was called 4FT at first, later WDAW. They would use it for communication purposes during the day, and then at night they would make broadcasts. They had a broadcast of the Emory Glee Club. They had a broadcast of the Dr. Charles Shelton gave an organ recital in the City Auditorium, and of course the Georgia Railway and Power Company Band. But the system did not work out too well because there was too much noise and static in the plants. So eventually they offered to give the radio broadcasting station to Major Cohen of the Atlanta Journal. He said he wanted a larger one, so he borrowed George Eiler and A.W. Shropshire from the company, and they built a larger broadcasting station for him. And this became WSB.
This is your Atlanta Journal station, WSB in Atlanta, Georgia.
Georgia and the South had been hit hard by the Great Depression. Arkwright would turn Georgia Power's focus to marketing to maintain revenue growth.
In the 1920s, there were a growing number of uses for electricity in the home, electric irons, electric stove, electric refrigerators. But electric utilities, and certainly not Georgia Power, had not done that much to promote that. And long about in the late 20s, though, and all through the 30s, the decision is made that we're going to start selling these products. So Georgia Power begins a campaign, as other utilities do, to begin selling appliances. So the way they sold them was they would sell them in their stores. It was, wherever Georgia Power went, they would set up an office. People would come pay their bills, okay? And they would put these appliances out, and they would usually be sold for a pretty reasonable price. In many of these towns, this was the only place you could buy appliances, was at Georgia Power. They didn't have Sears in these small towns. So if you wanted appliances, you went to Georgia Power. So they became, very much became a citizen wherever we served because they were, that's who you counted on.
Arkwright offered extended payment plans for appliance purchases. He sponsored hometown electrical contests with prizes to communities that modernized living conditions and that increased electric usage. World War II was on the horizon. Franklin Roosevelt was governor of New York. He decided to purchase a summer cottage.
In 1926, Franklin Roosevelt, then governor of New York, comes to Warm Springs, Georgia for the first time, seeking help with his polio-ridden legs. And so he comes to Warm Springs and he really likes it. And he, creates a cabin there and begins to come there regular. There's only one thing he didn't like about it, and that was how much he was paying for electricity. He was paying 18 cents a kilowatt hour, which was about four times what he was paying in Hyde Park, New York. He didn't understand this. He sends a letter to Arkwright and asking him, why is this the case? Well, he was not being served. Warm Springs, in southwest of Atlanta, was not being served by Georgia Power. And it was being served by a little local utility in a nearby town. and it was electricity was unreliable, and it was expensive. So once Arkwright heard about this, he pretty quickly bought that little utility outside of Warm Springs, and now Roosevelt would be served by Georgia Power.
As the Tallulah project was winding down, prohibition had become the law of the land. The Depression had overtaken America in the 1930s, and the Persimmon Valley in Rabun County would become a center for production of moonshine. The Tallulah Project had helped create new industry and new roads throughout the state. These new ribbons of blacktop would allow for a new kind of unsanctioned commerce. Still in the grips of poverty, many people in Rabun County resorted to making moonshine to put food on the table. The moonshiners employed runners who used specially outfitted cars called hot rods. They built their reputations and fortunes by outsmarting and outrunning law enforcement. The drivers called it riding lightning down Thunder Road. They held races to determine who had the fastest car. Georgia's Highway 9 to Atlanta was dubbed Thunder Road.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
World War II and the engines of war would place further strains on the company. As America rallied to Roosevelt's cry, defense manufacturers like the Bell Bomber Factory in Marietta needed all the power they could get. The factory would build over 600 B-29s and employ more than 28,000 people. Among them was Helen Dorch Longstreet, who would become one of the symbols known as Rosie the Riveter. The war imposed drastic measures on Atlanta. Air conditioning and outside lighting was shut down. Hotels, restaurants, and gas stations were prohibited from using lighted signs. The demands on the Tallulah Power Project were dramatic. At one point, nearly two-thirds of the water in Lake Burton was drained to produce power 24 hours a day for the war effort. With the end of World War II, industrial and military demands on power were replaced by increases in residential and commercial sales. Several downtown buildings had air conditioning, and Atlanta would introduce the world's first air-conditioned trackless trolley in 1945.
And here comes about, you know, in the 50s, here comes air conditioning. And that's all the rage. And that's a big factor in making the South livable, in bringing people from other parts of the country to the South. Air conditioning, which, of course, is all about electricity, is changing the South. And, you know, industry, Arkwright's dream of getting industries in these smaller towns where they have something to do rather than farm to make a decent living, to have decent education, that's all coming to pass.
In 1959, Lenox Square would open. It would be one of the nation's first all-electric shopping malls. The decade of the 60s and the early 70s marked tremendous growth, but by the mid-70s, it ground to a halt. The major industrial countries around the world were hit with an energy crisis. For Georgia Power, the effect was dramatic. By 1974, the company was facing financial devastation.
We put these bonds up for sale, and we didn't get a bid. And it was pretty obvious that nobody really had much interest in our paper. Just before I became president, we were at a point where we didn't actually have the cash to pay our taxes and other things.
Customers wanted cheaper energy, while demand for energy was increasing.
And so instead of being a matter of almost universal hunger and appreciation for the supplier to give much needed electric service, that became a matter of demanding better service at lower cost.
Interest rates had risen at an alarming rate, and the country faced a gasoline shortage. The company was also asking the Georgia Public Service Commission for permission to raise its rates. The solution to Georgia Power's problem would come from the most unlikely source, the Oglethorpe Electric Membership Corporation. A statewide electric co-op company wanted to buy several of the company's plants. The idea was intriguing, but it flew in the face of tradition for many in the company. It would make a customer a generator of electricity, something the company had resisted since its founding. Bob Shearer, Georgia Power's president, was faced with a dilemma: accept the unprecedented offer or stay with tradition.
Sometime thereafter, a short time thereafter, they came back to me and they said, we want to buy your plants. We want to buy in. And, you know, I sat there rather stunned. I didn't say yes, I didn't say no. I said, well, we'll have to study that. And we did. And we said yes.
For Shearer, tradition, as he said, carried very little currency when weighed against survival. The deal that walked through the door of Shearer's office would be the company's solution to its financial crisis. The next decades for the company would be marked by tremendous growth and unique opportunities that would change Atlanta's destiny. Atlanta attorney Billy Payne conceived the idea of Atlanta hosting the 1996 Olympic Games. Atlanta Mayor Andrew Young would endorse Payne's idea at a Chamber of Commerce meeting and began seeking support from the business community.
Nobody wanted us to do the Olympics in my office because they said Montreal had the Olympics in 76, and here it is 88, and they're still $700 million in debt. We can't afford that in Atlanta. And I said, no, we can't. But we can run the Olympics as a private sector venture.
Bill Dahlberg, Georgia Power's president, would be one of the business leaders who would hear about this bold idea.
I went to my first Chamber of Commerce meeting after I'd come back as president of the company. And they were making a presentation about making the bid to represent the U.S. to bid for the Olympic Games. And I thought that was kind of cool. Nobody thought we could win the bid, even in the U.S. But, you know, it caught on. It caught everybody's imagination. And I knew, as a big company, they were probably going to come and ask us to make a contribution towards putting the bid together. And I was fully prepared to do, you know, $25,000 or something like that. And the person that came, they didn't ask for $25,000. They asked for $250,000. And I kind of caught my breath, so I agreed to do the $250,000. Subsequent to that, they came back, they were short, and we did another $125,000, $130,000, something like that. I didn't know it until after the fact that we were the largest cash contributor. I never told anybody when I found that out until after we won the bid, and then, of course, I told everybody then.
Well, the truth is I had gone to Tokyo where the decision would be made, but we had a meeting with financial analysts the next day in Atlanta, and I had come back to Atlanta and was making a presentation to the analyst, and I had my first slide in there, welcome to Atlanta, host of the 1996 Olympics. I got the word on a phone or a television or something just before my presentation.
The International Olympic Committee has awarded the 1996 Olympic Games to the city of Atlanta.
We really could not have gotten the Olympics without the faith and confidence of Georgia Power and Southern Company.
At the completion of the 96 Olympic Games, Georgia Power, along with the Southern Company and Alabama Power, would donate an additional $3.75 million to the completion of Centennial Olympic Park. With the Olympics in the rearview mirror, Georgia Power would turn its attention to a continuing, expanding state and its capital city.
The challenges grew greater and greater because there's a
almost an insatiable appetite to do better. And doing better, in many instances, is a trade-off between the cost and the impact.
The Tallulah hydroelectric power system would become a smaller percentage of Georgia's expanding power needs. Expansion into alternative power generating would pick up speed, and the company would set its sights on the need for a low-carbon future. After almost 200 years, the land first acquired by the Georgia Railway and Electric Company to bring hydroelectricity to Atlanta and Georgia remains as pristine as the day J.E. Hardy first began buying land. The lakes of the Tallulah watershed and Lake Burton continue to provide a scenic recreational resource for boating, water sports, and fishing, while its shores, coves, and inlets provide a natural habitat for diverse wildlife. For animals such as black bears, deer, amphibians, birds of prey, and waterfowl continue to thrive in rich surroundings.
I think the lake represents one of the best examples of our acceptance of our responsibility when it comes to stewardship of the land and the environment. It's still a wonderfully clean and pristine place to enjoy the beauty of nature. And when you understand and travel that whole North Georgia lake system all the way through the gorge itself is just a magnificent geological creation. And the fact that we were part of creating that and preserving it and contributing to its preservation is a huge benefit, and it makes me really proud of the company.
100 years later, Lake Burton remains a valuable public resource and a key part of the hydropower revolution, providing electrical power daily. Today, tens of thousands still enjoy all that this area has to offer. And the company that Henry Atkinson and Preston Arkwright conceived still remains true to the principles and core civic values